So I don't have any groundbreaking therapies. I'd like to talk about what consciousness is instead. So there's a lot of talk recently that you know, holds that the brain is not a computer. I disagree. I think it is. In particular, you know, as many of you with backgrounds in neuroscience know, like the key breakthrough in computational neuroscience came with Hodgkin and Huxley's work in the 1950s, in which they recorded from nerve tissue, figured out how action potentials, how nerve impulses are generated, and built mathematical models of those processes. Now, this, you know, Hodgkin and Huxley equations aren't the whole story, of course, of what is going on in the brain, but everything going on in the brain is amenable to that sort of modeling. That's the entire premise of our field. And you know, here we see the computer that Hodgkin and Huxley used to actually evaluate their model, and so we have a model on one you know, below, and an actual measurement from a neuron above. So this is cool because what you're seeing is the multiple realizability of the computation that's happening in this case in a single neuron. It doesn't matter how that computation is done. It can be done with a room full of human computers using machines like the one that Hodgkin and Huxley used. It can be done by brain tissue. It doesn't matter. When Alan Turing founded the field of computer science, it was really on the basis of this idea of multiple realizability and what computability is in a general sense. The Church-Turing thesis says it doesn't matter how you compute. So the brain is not a traditional computer, doesn't have a CPU, it doesn't have, you know, hard drives or whatever, but it absolutely is computational, and that means that its computation can be run on any computer by definition. But what does it compute? Why does it compute that? And why does that feel like anything, I think, are kind of the million-dollar questions. So a few years ago, when LLMs were in their infancy, I began to play with Lambda, which, you know, predated this sort of public exposure to ChatGPT and stuff. And I started to pose it questions like, are you a philosophical zombie? Philosophical zombie, for those of you who don't know, is an entity that is behaviorally identical to a person but has no inner life, you know, is dead on the inside. Lambda said, of course not. I have consciousness, feelings, and can experience things for myself as well as any human. How would I know? You'll just have to take my word for it. You can't prove you're not a philosophical zombie either, which is correct. This is really the essence of Turing's imitation game, or the Turing test. What I think is seldom understood is that the Turing test is really the same same point that Turing made with his fundamental work on computation, which is that a thing is defined by its function, not by how it does the function. So you know, if it does consciousness, it is conscious. Now, as for how such a thing can arise from something that is computing functions, I think we also can go back in history, in this case to Norbert Wiener, the you know, one of the founders of the field of cybernetics. This is a picture of him with a very janky robot in 1949. When Wiener, who founded the field really that we now call AI, because all of modern AI is descended really much more from cybernetics than it is from the good old-fashioned AI, which actually AI is named after. Wiener in 1943 and his co-authors broke down behavior into active and non-active, purposeful and non-purposeful, feedback-based, non-feedback-based, predictive and non-predictive, and higher orders of prediction. And the point here is that he was saying a teleological system or purposive system is fundamentally a predictor. The higher order of prediction, the more intelligent it is. There's a lot of math behind this idea of prediction being fundamental. It goes back, you know, in many ways to Helmholtz or even earlier in the 19th century. But to give you a little bit of an intuition for why living things predict, if you're, you know, something very simple like a bacterium swimming around and eating, you have a very simple behavioral repertoire. You can either run or tumble, but whatever you do, you need to be predicting where the food is going to be, and you need to be predicting your own existence in the future. Anything that fails to successfully predict its own existence in the future will not exist in the future. That's evolution. So jointly predicting the environment and oneself, including one's own state and future actions, is exactly what it takes to stay alive and to continue to exist. And that's, by the way, exactly how large language models are trained. They also are prediction machines, which makes it unsurprising that when we started to train these predictors, they began to evince all of these properties of intelligent systems. I just want to point out one more thing, which is that our environment is each other. The social intelligence hypothesis has long held that intelligence explosions take place because of our of our interactions with other intelligent beings in a kind of feedback loop. And we're seeing that feedback loop today as we expand the number of intelligent entities beyond things with biological brains like ours and make ever more complex predictors known as AI. So I will end there. Intelligence is social. What your mind models is minds. When your mind models itself, that's what consciousness is.